Hello, friends. Welcome to worship at the Church of the Holy City. So lovely to see you with us today. And a special welcome to anyone joining us on the live stream. So glad you are with us. So, as for our programming, today is our Sacred Grounds Planting Day, which is going to be so fun. The plants are waiting outside in the backyard, ready to be put into the ground to create both expand our current pollinator sun garden and create new shade gardens. So that's very exciting. So after coffee hour, we will get to digging in the earth. And thank you so much for any help that you can give us for that event. Even though it is the third Sunday of the month, and usually we have Swedenborg Chat on the third Sunday, we're moving Swedenborg Chat to next week so that we can accommodate Planting Day today. Also, want to just put out there, it'll be here before we know it. Our annual wreath sale is scheduled for December 1st and 2nd. If you're willing to lend a hand with that event, please talk to John Calmer. And it's always a delightful way for the community to come together and to create something fun. So put that on your calendars. And so finally, as I bring our attention to our third candle on the altar, which we light in order to hold space for prayer and discernment around how to show up for peace and justice in our world. This week, especially, there has been so much grief to hold and process as we continue to receive news out of Israel and Palestine. The loss of innocent life has just been devastating. And so, as we join the world in mourning, I hope that you will now join me for a word of prayer together. So, let us pray. Our loving, gracious, and steadfast God, we pray for peace in Israel, Palestine, and the surrounding areas, full as they are with history and trauma and war, but also with the joy of lives well lived and families together, and hands reaching out for hands in peace. Though each small act of love here and abroad may feel so small, let each bloom into fullness so that one day your divine love may be entirely manifest and each beloved person of your heart might feel safety, security, wellness, and peace. For this we pray, amen. So, with that, we are now ready to begin worship. I will invite you to please stand for the opening of the word. Sing, O heavens, be joyful, O earth. And break out in singing, O mountains, for the Lord consoles the people and will have mercy on the afflicted. So we'll begin our worship this morning with singing hymn number 22 as found in the red hymnal. Please join me as we say together our responsive reading as found in the bulletin. Living God, our loving parent, you cherish your creation, and we praise you. With earth, air, water, fire, in our element as your children, we praise you. With our lips, with our lives, in all our diversity, each one made in your image, we praise you. Because in Jesus you came to share our human lives, our sorrow and joy, we praise you. Poor as we are, you give us hope. Salt of the earth, you give us meaning and purpose, and we praise you. Amen. And now we will welcome our ministry student, Tira Keel, to give us our opening prayer.
Let us pray. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Holy and ever-living God, by your power we are created, and by your love we are redeemed. Guide and strengthen us by your Spirit, that we may give ourselves to your service and live each day in love to one another and you. Kindle in our hearts, O Lord, the pure light of your divine knowledge, and open our minds to the understanding of your gospel. Plant in us reverence for your blessed commandments, that putting away every selfish and sinful desire, we may attain to spiritual life, both thinking and doing all things according to your word. For you are the illumination of our souls, and to you we ascribe the glory forever. Amen.
Now let us say together our affirmation of worship as found in the bulletin. We worship God, our loving Lord, who made us, who taught us in the Bible that all people are God's children and that we should love God and each other. When people turned away from God, he loved us enough to be born in our world as a baby. He grew up and lived the life he wants us to live. Risen now, he is still with us, our Lord and our God, helping us to grow more like him. This is why we know him as our Savior. We're his disciples when we love him and show our love for him by being kind and helpful to one another. Our first reading today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 1 through 9. Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. You have made the city a heap of rubble, the fortified town a ruin, the stranger's stronghold a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will honor you, cities of ruthless nations will revere you. You have been a refuge for the poor, a refuge for the needy in their distress, a shelter from the storm and a shade from the heat. For the breath of the ruthless is like a storm driving against the wall and like the heat of the desert. You silence the uproar of strangers as heat is reduced by the shadow of a cloud, so the song of the ruthless is stilled. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. and from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man who was there not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, 'How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?' And the man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'" May God bless the hearing and the living of this word. And from the writings of Emanuel Swedenborg, True Christianity, number 371. Our partnership with the Lord is reciprocal. The Lord is in us, and we are in the Lord. And because the partnership is reciprocal, it obviously follows that we have to unite ourselves to the Lord so that the Lord will unite himself to us. Otherwise, there will be a parting and a separation rather than a partnership, and not on the Lord's initiative, but on our own. It is a mutual partnership that is brought about by cooperation rather than action and reaction. The Lord acts. We receive the Lord's action. We then function as if we were on our own. In fact, we function on our own from the Lord, since the Lord continually keeps us in free choice. The Lord gives us this freedom so that we can forge a reciprocal partnership and be granted life and eternal blessedness as a result, something that would be impossible without a reciprocal partnership. So, my friends, welcome to the children's message today. So, when we're invited to a birthday party, for example, it is customary that we bring a gift, right? The idea is to celebrate someone, and so we bring them something. Now, it doesn't always have to be a material thing. It could also be a hug, or a song, or a poem, or a compliment. But the idea is to celebrate that person. If we showed up to the party with the intent to insult the birthday person, then that wouldn't be cool. Or it would be like if we said we would go and let them prepare the entire party, but then right beforehand we're just like, "Nah, I'd just rather sit home and watch TV." Again, not cool. It's this type of attitude that Jesus is talking about in our Bible story today. Intentionally not being a good guest and not keeping our promises. And this plays out in our real life, like in birthday parties. But of course, it also plays out in our spiritual life, in our relationship with God. Because God is always reaching out to us and inviting us into relationship with God. And we get to decide how we respond. Now, hopefully we will do so with joy and with hard work and with keeping our promises. And sometimes we don't. And that's okay. This is just part of being human. The key is whether we circle back and try again with honesty and love. God's banquet will be waiting for all. Amen. So, my friends, we heard 2 weeks ago about a God who is constantly reaching out to us. Divine love cannot do anything else. And so it's not a surprise to hear this week that God is constantly inviting us to a banquet, as we heard in Isaiah, constantly calling for our presence and for the presence of all people. This invitation comes to us in many different ways, and surely we are incredibly blessed that God loves us all so deeply. And if the last couple of weeks have been about God's invitation, then this week centers our response. For the story of God's great love is only half the story. Is this love of God's requited? What does it mean to reciprocate God's love? And what does God require of us? We enter into our gospel text today in the same place where we've been for several weeks. Jesus is occupying the temple, and the chief priests and Pharisees are trying to discredit him. Jesus does not back down, however, and levels increasingly pointed criticism of the priest's conduct with a series of parables, of which this one is the culmination. We see from the language used, like the phrase, "Jesus spoke to them again," that the narrative tension is continuing to mount, and thus everything in the parable is heightened as well. There are some familiar aspects in it, certainly, like the form of a wedding banquet, but as is usual for a parable, there are out-of-the-ordinary and disproportionate aspects. This time, armies are marching and cities are burned while supposedly dinner is still on the table, and a man is thrown into the outer darkness for not having the right clothes. We are again uncomfortable, which is good, because now we are listening. So it was the custom in that time for invitations to an event to be issued in a twofold way. The first invitation was issued in advance and a general day given, to which people would indicate their acceptance. And then, on the day itself, when the food and the household had been prepared, then people would be notified that it was time to attend. It is actually this second invitation that we are witnessing in the text. So it's not just a situation of people not being free to attend. Rather, these are people who had already agreed to come, and then were now refusing to attend. We don't need to understand much of ancient custom to relate to this. It is socially unacceptable in any time. And it's an upsetting upheaval of the guest-host relationship. In Matthew's particular context, writing as he was to a primarily Jewish audience, the first half of the invitation would have been understood as Israel's original covenant with the Lord. And the second invitation, the reminder, would have been understood as Jesus and his subsequent Christian missionaries. Now, Swedenborg talks to us about what this invitation means in a more personal way, how the invitation plays out in our spiritual psychology. The twofold invitation can also be a picture of how the Lord invites us to engage with the spiritual life, how divine truth presents itself to us, and how we are invited by the Lord to interact with it. The first invitation is to our intellect, to our thinking mind. We are presented with true ideas to which we might feel positively disposed. Yes, we say to ourselves, these things are true and I assent to them in a general way, such as God is love, or God loves all people and wants them to thrive, or God intends all people to go to heaven, or it matters to our spiritual state how we live our life. These things are universally and generally true. We believe them. And this is like agreeing to come to the banquet while the invitation is still a ways off. The second invitation, however, is to our will. Now the invitation is not somewhere off far in the future. The invitation is now, today, asking us to attend when we said we would. This invitation is asking us to take the generally true ideas that we have assented to and to actually live them, to actually act as if they are true. And what the people in the text did, well, isn't that often the same thing that we do? We make excuses. The text says they paid no attention and went off, one to his field and another to his business. There is a similar story in the book of Luke to this one, in which the invited make even more detailed excuses. In that version, the first says, I bought a field and I must go see it. And the second says, I have bought some oxen that I must go see. And the third says, I have married a wife, so I cannot come. At least they sound somewhat apologetic. And honestly, these excuses sound fairly reasonable, as I'm sure all of our own justifications sound to ourselves. But the excuses prevent them from attending the banquet, prevent them from seeing their promises through. If we've RSVP'd to God's invitation, then we should come. But, as I said, this second invitation is to our will. What if we don't want to come? What if we're afraid to? The demands of divine truth, the demands of attending the banquet we said we would attend, this can be scary. Actually living according to the truths that we have assented to in our intellect means we might have to sacrifice something of our own making, our own wants and desires. The people in the text didn't want to leave their own pursuits, didn't want to leave their own priorities and goals, their field, their business, their oxen, their wife. And it's okay to have things of our own that we care about. Our sense of self, our sense that we can build and create and sustain things on our own is an important gift from the Lord. Without it, reciprocation of the Lord's love would not be possible. But sometimes we can become too enamored with our own sense of accomplishment. Like the screens we are surrounded with these days, it can be hard to tear ourselves away from our incessant drive to accumulate either goods or social currency. And this is understandable. In this culture, our sense of self-worth is closely tied to our performance and our accomplishments. Yet in the midst of this reality, God calls us to a banquet, calls us to a magnificent meal that, as we hear in our Isaiah text, is set in the midst of chaos, in the midst of our troubles, our shame, our challenges, our distractions. How audacious, how inconvenient, and how divinely patient and loving. And this tension of whether or not to actually attend the banquet, whether or not to follow through, whether or not to show up and how to show up, is continued in the depiction of the guest without the wedding garment. On the face of it, this man is treated terribly unfairly. How could someone invited on the spur of the moment, someone without means, be expected to have the proper clothing? Why does the host not understand this? It seems really harsh. Well, there are several ways to try to understand what the gospel writer is getting at here. In early Christian thought, the new identity of conversion was often pictured as putting on a new set of clothes. It is a powerful image. And in addition, some scholars believe that there is evidence that a wealthy host in antiquity would have a store of clothing that he would provide to guests, and that the guest is deliberately choosing not to take advantage of the host's hospitality, and is therefore communicating disrespect. While there isn't full agreement on this point, it is clear that in an ancient setting, the proper exchange of hospitality was extremely important. There is still this sense that those showing up would have a certain obligation to the host, even if they didn't expect that they would be attending. And we can argue about whether the expectations of the host were reasonable, but at least in the allegorical sense that Jesus has been presenting so far, we begin to understand that while God extends the invitation far and wide to all people, our response to the invitation is also important. We shouldn't excuse ourselves from attending the party, and neither should we show up without the intent to be a good guest as far as we possibly can. Because the Lord is interested in a reciprocal relationship with us. Imagine that. We are so important to God that our response not only matters, but is integral to the quality of our relationship with God. As we heard in the reading today, the Lord is seeking a partnership with us, a conjunction that involves engagement, that involves giving and receiving, that involves awareness of where we stand and a willingness to listen and learn. And what an amazing honor this is. It really seems incredible, even more incredible, that this invitation should be offered to every single living being. Really accepting the invitation, though, means more than just being a body in the room. This is a wedding banquet in the parable. In the Swedenborgian sense, a marriage represents union on many different levels, but ultimately, it represents the heavenly marriage, which is the marriage of love and wisdom within God. To show up to a wedding banquet means to show up and to be ready to celebrate this union of love and wisdom, and to work to effect their conjunction in our lives and in the world. For what is love but the soul of what is wise? And what is wisdom but the understanding of how to effectively and consistently and bravely love? And when we show up to the banquet ready to commit ourselves to the beauty and the usefulness of the heavenly marriage, we must show up clothed in readiness to explore the elusive balance of this principle. We must show up clothed in awareness, humility, courage, and in a willingness to ground our truths in real life. Because it is surely not easy to love wisely, as we are finding in these turbulent times. We lean too far in the pursuit of wisdom, and it becomes an excuse for judgment, coldness, and self-satisfaction. We lean too far into the pursuit of love, and it becomes a mechanism by which we indulge our own neediness and prop up our own lack of self-worth. Wisdom gives form to love, and love gives life to wisdom, and they cannot exist one without the other. So, showing up to the banquet of the heavenly marriage requires something of us. It means working to be conjoined with the Lord. It means taking the things we may believe in our intellect and putting them into practice. It means showing up clothed in an awareness of how much work that is going to be and also how important it is. But it also means a celebration of a God that is constantly inviting, constantly laying out a banquet for all people, a God dedicated to enacting the marriage of love and wisdom for the purpose of creating blessedness, happiness, fullness, peace, and joy through providence and through us. So let us clothe ourselves in our wedding garments every day. Let us be dressed and ready in heart and mind to attend the banquet of the Lord. Amen. We will now take a few moments for quiet reflection with a musical interlude. Let us pray. O God of life, of all life and of each life, we lay our lives before you. We give our lives to you, from whom nothing in us is hidden. You are before us, God, you are behind. You are around us, God, you are within. O God of life, you know the secret thoughts of every heart. We bring the faith that is in us and the doubt. We bring the joy that is in us and the sorrow. O God of life, you are in the light and in the darkness. We bring the knowledge that is in us and the ignorance. We bring the hope that is in us and the despair. O God of life, O generous spirit, renew us with your life today, tomorrow, and always. Amen. And now, Divine One, with gratitude and awe, we kneel before you, knowing that you are present with us in our challenges, that you walk with us in each of our moments. And so we lift up to you now our prayers, our concerns, our heartaches, our fears, and our joys, knowing that you hear us and hold them all with love. And now let us pray together as you taught us in your word. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We will now take a moment to receive the offering.
Thank you.
Accept, O Lord, these our gifts, symbols of our acknowledgement that all we have and are is from you and is to be used in your service. Amen. And now we will sing together our closing hymn, number 308, as found in the red hymnal. But when you seek Yahweh from those lands, you will find God where you are, if you search with all your heart and soul. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord.